Good morning and welcome to the State Department. I also want to welcome our audience from around the world, particularly from our embassies where it is still daylight and people can be present for this conversation. We want to welcome all of them. We are joined here today by an outstanding panel of speakers, and we want to welcome all of them as well to the State Department, as well as members of the diplomatic community who are here. Ambassador Shankar of India is on the panel, but we also have with us Ambassador Pitagovich of Latvia, Ambassador Idafar from Bahrain, and others who have joined them in coming together. We are here to mark the 16 days of activism in the fight against violence against women and girls, gender-based violence, particularly what can be done to change attitudes and to bring men and boys into this struggle against violence. We know that this is a very, very serious challenge. It is a global epidemic. It occurs in every nation on the face of this earth. One in three women will experience gender-based violence at some point in their lives. It cuts across not just borders, but across ethnic, racial, class, religious, economic, and educational lines. It can threaten women and girls at any point in their life cycle. It occurs in female feticide, where the lives of girls are snuffed out just because they are girls. It occurs in child marriage, in sex trafficking, in domestic violence, in rape being used as a tool of war. But it is not just a women's issue. It is indeed a very fundamental violation of women's human rights. Most seriously, most fundamentally, it is that. But it is also a development issue, a humanitarian issue, a security issue. In other words, it is an economic issue because it has a great deal to do with undermining productivity. It is an issue of health. We know today that so many victims of sexual violence, particularly adolescent girls, are also vulnerable to the HIV/AIDS infection. And it is something worth noting as we are going to be celebrating World AIDS Days, hardly celebrating, observing it, and recommitting ourselves to that struggle. So the connection with health is a very significant one. Some of the most dangerous places for women around the world are the most dangerous places, period. It is a significant security issue as well. So there are so many reasons why we all need to be a part of this struggle. Governments have increasingly become engaged in passing laws to combat violence against women and girls. Many of these laws have yet to be fully enforced or implemented, but they represent a very significant effort because these are not cultural practices. These are not practices that can be viewed as private. These are violations of human rights. They are criminal, and they need to be dealt with. And so we need a full range of actions focused on prevention, on protecting the victims of violence, on prosecuting the perpetrators, those who break the laws. And we know that we need the full engagement. In addition to government, we need the full engagement of civil society as well as the private sector, which has increasingly become involved and engaged. And our panel represents the full dimension of actors who represent the sectors engaged on this issue. We need clearly to engage women, we need to engage men and boys. And there have been many efforts and programs that are really going to the heart of making a difference at that grassroots level, at the level of community engagement. As has often been said, we need heat at the top, we need political will and commitment, and we need heat at the bottom. We need energy at the level of the community to bring about changes in cultural behavior in turning around deeply embedded practices. And we have begun to see in so many ways how these efforts are shifting attitudes and behaviors. Around the world, from Seoul to Singapore, from Kabul to Canada, our embassies and our ambassadors have been engaged in this call to activism to address gender-based violence. In the last week, our ambassadors have placed op-eds in newspapers to mark the need to act to eliminate violence against women and girls. They have been reaching local audiences, many of which are joining us today in many of our embassies. And they have been engaging more broadly the civil society community, from faith leaders and community leaders to so many others who need to be engaged and are becoming engaged in addressing this global pandemic. As Secretary Clinton noted in her op-ed on the International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women, which is being carried in so many newspapers around the world, she said, "Ending violence against women is not the work of a day or even a year. It will require concentrated efforts on many fronts with governments, nonprofit organizations, and citizens all pulling together. Most importantly, it will require fully tapping the largest and most natural group of allies women can have, and that is the other half of the population, the men." Today on this panel, we are joined by Ambassador Meera Shankar, the Indian Ambassador to the United States, Dr. Nandini Asad, the Chairperson of the Independent Commission for People's Rights and Development. She is here from India. Nisha Biswal, the Assistant Administrator for Asia for USAID. Anthony Porter, the co-founder of A Call to Men. And Carol Kurdzik, the president of the Avon Foundation for Women. Each will talk briefly about the importance of this issue, the work that they are doing to address violence against women and girls. And then we will be able to engage in a conversation with them. And I hope that each of you will feel that you have something to contribute as well and will be a part of that discussion for as much time as we have. So now let me call Ambassador Shankar to make some opening remarks in addressing violence against women in India as well as globally, because it is a problem that afflicts us all.
Thank you. Thank you, Milan. I think it's always impressive to listen to your commitment to bring women's issues to the forefront of the international agenda, not just as women's issues, but as issues which impinge on global development, on global health, global security. In India, we've had a strong constitutional and legal framework for ending discrimination against women and for providing equality of opportunity to women before the law. So the Constitution provides that there will be no discrimination on grounds of caste, creed, or sex. And this forward-leaning position has been reflected in a variety of legislation which the Indian government has adopted to ensure better participation of women in the national polity, in society, and in the economy. Today, if you look at India, you will see that there is a mixed picture because we have really women who participate at the top of various walks of life, whether it be politics. We've had a woman prime minister. We have two women chief ministers at the moment who are like governors. We have women in the armed forces. But at the same time, I think because it's a traditional society, legislating change is not sufficient. It has to be combined with long-term programs, both by government and civil society, to change attitudes, to change social attitudes. I mean, you've seen that in the US, in the civil rights movement, where it took almost 100 years from the abolition of slavery to the institution of civil rights, and still many more years for social attitudes to change, even within the new legal framework. And therefore, in traditional societies, we found it's not enough just to legislate change. You have to mobilize various elements of society to create the awareness which can bring about the long-term change in social attitudes, which will make it possible to realize the objective for which that legislation has been framed. Today, we have a very vigorous civil society movement in India, many NGOs working in the field. But given the scale of India and its huge diversity, the enormous population that has to be covered, I think we can't be complacent. We have to redouble our efforts in this field. We've also found that empowering women at the grassroots has been very helpful. We adopted a bill, the Panchayati Raj Bill, which reserves seats for women in grassroots politics and in the village councils and in the municipalities. And as a result of that, 1 million women have been brought into public life in India, and they are participating in decision making on how to, how to establish priorities for their communities in terms of development, better environment, better economic opportunities, and so on. Initially, there was some apprehension that this, could be more of a kind of a surrogate representation of male candidates who might put up their sisters or their wives and so on. But when an assessment was done, it was found that more than 80% of the women who were brought into politics as a result of that had no family member who had ever been in politics. So it's an entirely clean slate. And the full impact of this development at the grassroots is something which we will still have to assess. It's new, but it's changing the way women perceive themselves. It's changing the way men perceive women and what they can contribute. A very important element is what the Independent Commission on People's Rights and Development has been doing, and that is to bring about a change in the attitude of men. Because we don't see ourselves in India as being, in some sense, in contradiction to society. So it's important to change male attitudes towards women, even as it's important to change women's attitude to themselves and to other women. And that's a very important project that they've been doing. Indeed, I recall within my own family, when I first came here, when we first got married, And in India, men don't traditionally cook at all. And my husband, you know, would go into the kitchen and start whipping up something. He's a very good cook, and I encourage him enormously so that he becomes the prisoner of his own reputation. His mother would feel extremely uncomfortable and say, you know, the men in our family have never done this. They have never gone into the kitchen. And my husband would say, you know, well, this is a first, and if you like what I eat, maybe you'll encourage others, what I cook, you'll encourage others to go in. I recall also when I came here as Minister of Commerce at the Indian Embassy, and my husband took a leave of absence from his work in Delhi to join me. And he, you know, studied economics at Georgetown during that period, that, you know, people would ask him, are you the Minister of Commerce? And he would say, no, I'm, you know, my wife is, and I'm the diplomatic spouse who enjoys all the privileges of diplomatic life without any of the responsibilities. So I think part of this really has to do with making men comfortable in having women as equal partners. I think that what the program today, which will focus on the issue of domestic violence and how to change that, will be very useful in terms of sharing experiences on how we can move forward. We've adopted in India a specific bill on this in 2005. It's the Protection Against Domestic Violence. But of course, there are other institutional forms of violence in society beyond the private violence in, within families. There are institutional forms of violence which sometimes get social or societal sanction. And I think we have to address both these at different levels. The key would be really to empower women and to change social attitudes, along with creating the legal frameworks that would make this possible. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ambassador. And she touched on so many really significant topics related to this issue overall, the importance of changing attitudes, which is one of the big challenges. And our next speaker will describe how that is being done very successfully at the grassroots level. But also, Ambassador, in your typical thorough way, she focused on political and economic empowerment, which are also critical elements in this struggle. I have had the privilege of meeting many of the panchayat women, of whom there are now over a million serving at the village level across India, and becoming extremely successful. Many of them, in fact, not well educated, but are becoming very responsive to meeting the needs of their community. Many of these kinds of issues have been on their agenda, and studies show that they have been among the most productive and committed democratic activists with a small D at the local level and really making a difference. And then economic empowerment. And I remember being in India several years ago with Mrs. Clinton and visiting a self-help project, of which India is also very famous, bringing the poorest of the poor together to really help change their lives. And through microcredit and training and other means, the women's lives are transformed, as are their families, because their status moves from the lowest, most insignificant level to really having opportunity and being somebody and being respected for that. And I remember her asking the women, well, what difference has this made for you? And one of the women got up very proudly and she said, I am no longer afraid. And I thought that was a really amazingly empowering statement. But then she went on. She said, I am not afraid of the police. I am not afraid of my husband. And I am not afraid of my mother-in-law. And everybody knows that was truly a woman who had experienced transformation. But she had enormous standing now in her family that she hadn't had earlier. So with us, I'm so happy to say, is Dr. Nandini Azad. If you'll come up, Nandini. She oversees an incredibly impressive project, which I have had the privilege to launch, one aspect of it that engages boys and men in Rajasthan and in other areas to really make a difference in addressing this issue. So, thank
you. Ambassador Vaveer, Ambassador Shankar, Ms. Biswal, Ms. Kursik, Mr. Porter. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen. Ambassador Vaveer visited our project and promised our men and boys that she will make this concept worldwide known, and that's exactly why I'm here today, because we are going to be beamed on a website, I believe, universally. And so it is a great privilege that she spoke about us in the US Congress, and she's been a mentor of the concept of men and boys, a whole visionary paradigm change, which I'm going to tell you in a minute about. I was born to a feminist, and I toddled in the women's movement. So in the 70s, as the speakers before me talked about, we had the whole issue of empowering women individually, economic empowerment, as Ambassador Vaveer rightly said. We are the home of some of the best homegrown movements on self-help and microfinance for empowering women economically, politically. And then we had the women's self-help groups. I come from the Working Women's Forum, which is a million strong. I'm a member of the board. And then this was all in the 70s. And then we struggled with our governments, many of them proactive, passed legislation, excellent laws, against violence against women and for gender equity. And then we had a whole story of policy advocacy. We sensitized our judiciary. We sensitized our enforcers. Very relevant strategies yesterday and today. Half a decade ago, I began to think, being born to a feminist, that there is a whole issue of the demand side. We have been looking at the supply side. We have been looking and putting the onus of violence against women on women for too long. And as Ambassador Vaveer very rightly pointed out, and this was our mission, to make the onus and to be owned. Gender-based violence is something that the community has to own, to redo. The nation has to own, and international communities. That's why I'm very happy to be here, particularly distinguished from the diplomatic corps, that you know this message has to go, that a new paradigm change is happening. And I'm very glad on this important day that we're talking about putting the onus on the community and the nation at last on gender-based violence. No more only women sorting out women's violence issues, which is very relevant, but the time has come now to make a big paradigm change. So it's a great honor for us to be here. The Youth Forums Against Gender-Based Violence, which came out of this whole idea and concept half a decade ago, are about young men in low-income communities in Karnataka and Rajasthan who come from indigenous communities, Muslim minorities, scheduled castes. And these young men in groups of 10 are changing the whole, are becoming the vanguards of women's rights in their area. The whole objective of this movement that it started was to re-socialize and see whether reconditioning is possible. We have been talking about curative, not preventive, long-term strategies by which the regressive environment that we talk about, how are we going to change, make the enabling environment enable these empowered women to deal with? Because we found we did a lot of microfinance, we did a lot of credit, we brought in financial independence to women, but the violence at home, that needed to be factored in. And how are we going to deal with it better than sensitize the men in their own families? So thus began the whole movement on the Youth Forums Against Gender-Based Violence. So right at this point, we have and what is interesting is the women's self-help groups stand behind the youth forums. They are mentoring them. And we found, to our amazement, a year after we started, it was the women that were pushing these young boys in these youth forums to take up this issue. In a traditional society, going at midnight to the police station to complain about wife beating, or, for example, to go to the local government authority, if it was a man, about alcoholism being brewed, the alcohol being brewed, or leading to inebriated state as well as wife beating, it was so much useful to bring. You have a male youth forum of 10, and you have a self-help group of 10. So you have a whole platform there against gender-based violence that this project brought about. What is it that the capacities that have been built? What are the important landmarks in this project? One is what you call the master trainer. He is, he's between 14 to 18, or somewhere between 20 to 24, and he may be unemployed. But we found that 70% of our boys, 1,000 boys from 100 villages, who are the fulcrum of the project, reaching over 70,000 stakeholders today, are school boys. So we found the teachers of the schools were our greatest allies, because they were the spawning ground for these young men who were really social workers in their community. They had some instinct to be do-gooders in their own community. So we've had 5-6 things that we did. We did a gender-based violence survey of the village, found out which were the households which are medium, complex, simple gender-based violence manifestations. Second, we got the master trainers, the key fulcrum, the attitudinal change. How do you perceive patriarchy? How do you perceive the manifestations of violence, sex and gender roles? So if you ever happen to be in the area, please inform us. You can go there overnight, and they will tell you all about sex and gender roles and the manifestations of violence and how they can deal with it. Number three, they then identified several types of manifestations. One was dowry. One was eve teasing. Eve teasing is like stalking. And a lot of rural girls drop out because in unlit roads, they are not able to go back late in the evening, and that's a cause of dropout. Then you have female feticide, sex selective abortion, you've rape, you've wife beating, which is very common. And then we also had to make a choice between, if it's a community where there are people from the labor class, we found that wife beating was much higher. In the middle income group, we found that dowry was much higher. So when you didn't have even wages to have a second meal, how would you then give a dowry? So then, all these other scientific methods were also employed. And the training of, what I would like to tell you is that this film that we are going to be showing today, 7 minutes of the film, is going to tell you about our methodologies, but the outcomes have been very significant. The outcomes have been significant because they have been stopping child marriage, they've been stopping infanticide, they are just talking to the local government. Many of them are becoming local government leaders. So we find that the many manifestations of gender-based violence are being dealt with. They go to the police, they bring in the police when it's eve-teasing, they are counseling there, and now we have young girls' forums against gender-based violence. So we have a whole platform now, against gender-based violence. And so I think the film is going to show you a little bit about the methodology. And during the QA, I'm most willing to answer anything about specific cases. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Thank you.
So we're going to show a portion of this film now about the project and how it works. And then at noon, at the conclusion of our discussion today, the whole film will be able to be seen in its entirety.
Forums Against Gender-Based Violence is a growing mass movement of male youth for women's rights. The Independent Commission for People's Rights and Development, or ICPRD, a national NGO federation, initiated this innovative and path-breaking movement, Youth Forums Against Gender-Based Violence, or YFAGBV, in 2004-2005 in rural Karnataka and Rajasthan. Young men from low-income communities are combating violence against women at the household and community level. It is a unique methodology through which future male citizens are being transformed into promoters of social and economic rights of women. A project of its kind at the grassroots policy level.
ICPRD is an independent commission, a commission which has coalition NGOs devoted to pro-poor advocacy and pro-gender issues. Gender equity to us is not a women's issue. It has to be owned by the community, indeed by the nation at large. For us, from the women's movement, it was a historic occasion when young men at the village level, shoulder to shoulder, began the long campaign for women's rights.
Young men from the age group 14 to 17 and 18 to 24 are mobilized in youth forums through cycle rallies, cricket matches, and street theater. The great success of the project in a short period has been largely due to the youth forums being trained in street theater and fusion imagery, which has emerged as a low-cost, effective tool for mobilizing and creating awareness in low-income communities through mass campaigns. The project has invested skills in master trainers, peer educators, to evolve as grassroots pivots of the project organization and program strategy. These master trainers have become the key catalysts, informants, communicators, and coordinators of the project at the local level. Through various trainings and inputs given under the project, young men are now beginning to transform their perceptions regarding women and the rights of women. They have learned about gender, patriarchy, and different forms of gender-based violence, solving cases, referrals on legal matters, or with panchayats, teachers, and police.
ನಮ್ಮ ಶಾಲೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ ನಮ್ಮಕೊಂಡ್ರು ಪ್ರೌಢಶಾಲೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಪ್ರಬಂಧ ಸ್ಪರ್ಧೆಯನ್ನು ಏರ್ಪಡಿಸಿದಾಗ ಕೊನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಬಹುಮಾನ ವಿತರಣೆ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ರೀತಿ ಈ ಐಸಿಪಿಡಿ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆಯ ಉದ್ದೇಶಗಳು ಗುರಿಗಳು ಮಹಿಳೆಯರ ಮೇಲೆ ಆಗ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ದೌರ್ಜನ್ಯದ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಮಾಹಿತಿ ಕೊಟ್ಟರು ನಾನು ಇದರ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಸೇರಿಕೊಂಡು ಸಮಾಜಸೇವೆ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋ ಉತ್ಸಾಹ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆಯಿತು ಆನಂತರ ನಾನು ಒಂದು ಮಾಸ್ಟರ್ ಟ್ರೈನರ್ಗೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಐಸಿಪಿಡಿ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆಯವರು ಕನ್ಸಲ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡಿದಾಗ ನಾನು ಒಂದು ಯೂತ್ನ ರಚನೆ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡೆ
Not only are their perceptions changing, they are also taking action at the community level to create awareness regarding women's rights and to stop gender-based violence. Many of them, earlier Eve teasers themselves, are now stopping verbal harassment of girls at bus stops and other public places. They are counseling their friends against eve teasing.
College ಬರ್ತಾ ಇರಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಎಲ್ಲಾ ಹುಡುಗಿರು ಚುಡಾಯಿಸ್ತಿದ್ದೆ ಮತ್ತು ಅವ್ರು ರೇಗಿಸ್ತಿದ್ದೆ ಆದರೆ ನಾನು ಆ ರೀತಿ ಈಗ ಈ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆಗೆ ಸೇರಿದಾದ್ಮೇಲೆ ನಾನು ಆ ರೀತಿ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ ಮತ್ತು ನಮ್ಮ ಫ್ರೆಂಡ್ಸ್ಗಳು ನನ್ನ ಜೊತೆ ಸೇರಿಕೊಂಡು ಆ ಥರ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ರು ನಮ್ಮ ಫ್ರೆಂಡ್ಸ್ಗಳೆಲ್ಲ ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಹೇಳಿದ್ದೀನಿ ಈ ಥರ ಮಾಡೋದೆಲ್ಲ ತಪ್ಪು
ಅಡ್ರೆಸ್ಸಿಂಗ್ ಡೊಮೆಸ್ಟಿಕ್ ವೈಲೆನ್ಸ್
ಕುಡಿಯೋ ತಪ್ಪು ಈ ರೀತಿ ಕುಡಿಯೋದ್ರಿಂದ ನಿಮ್ಮ ಮೇಲೆ ಹಲವಾರು ರೀತಿಯಾದಂಥ ದುಷ್ಪರಿಣಾಮಗಳು ಉಂಟಾಗ್ತವೆ ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ನಿಮ್ಮ ಆರೋಗ್ಯ ಸ್ಥಿತಿನೂ ತುಂಬ ಚಿಂತಾಜನಕ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಮತ್ತು ನಿಮ್ಮ ಹಣ ಖರ್ಚು ಮಾಡಿ ನೀವೇ ಅನಾರೋಗ್ಯವನ್ನು ಕೊಂಡ್ಕೊಂಡಂಗೆ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಮತ್ತು ನಿಮ್ಮ ಹೆಂಡತಿ ಮಕ್ಕಳ ಮಾನಸಿಕ ಮತ್ತು ದೈಹಿಕವಾಗಿ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಹಿಂಸೆ ನೀಡಿದಂಗೆ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಮತ್ತು ಈ ಎಲ್ಲ ರೀತಿಯಿಂದಾಗಿ ಸಮಾಜದಲ್ಲಿ ಉಪದ್ರವಸ ಉಂಟಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಇದರಿಂದ ಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ನ್ಯೂಸ್ ಉಂಟಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಆದ್ದರಿಂದಾಗಿ ನಿಮ್ಮೂರಿನ ಜನರಲ್ಲಿ ಜನ ಸಮುದಾಯದಲ್ಲಿ ನಿಮ್ಮ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ತುಂಬ ಕೀಳರಿಮೆ ಉಂಟಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ನೀವು ಕುಡಿಯೋದು ತಪ್ಪು ಇದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ನೀವು ಬಿಟ್ಬಿಡ್ಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ನಾವು ಅವರಲ್ಲಿ
Promoting girl-child education.
ಐಸಿಪಿಆರ್ಡಿ ಅವರು ಶಂಕರಣ್ಣ ಸುರೇಶಣ್ಣ ಮಾದೇಶಣ್ಣ ಅವರೆಲ್ಲ ಬಂದು ಹೇಳಿದ್ರು. ಅವಾಗ ನಮ್ಮ ತಂದೆ ಒಪ್ಕೊಂಡ್ರು, ನೀವು ಸ್ಕೂಲು ಕಳಿಸಿ ಏನೂ ಆಗಲ್ಲ, ಏನೂ ಆಗಲ್ಲ, ಕಳಿಸಿ ಸ್ಕೂಲಲ್ಲಿ ಬಟ್ಟೆ ಪುಸ್ತಕ ಸ್ಕಾಲರ್ಶಿಪ್ ಸೈಕಲ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಫ್ರೀಯಾಗಿ ಕೊಡ್ತಾರೆ ಅಂದ್ಕೊಂಡೆಲ್ಲ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರು. ಅವಾಗ ಅವರು ಆಯಿತು ಅಂತ ಒಪ್ಕೊಂಡ್ರು. ಅವಾಗ ಕುಡಿಯೋದ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಮಾಡಿ, ಅಕ್ಕಪಕ್ಕದ ಮನೆಯವರೆಲ್ಲ ಕೆಟ್ಟ ದೃಷ್ಟಿಯಿಂದ ನೋಡ್ತಾರೆ ಅಂದ್ಕೊಂಡೆಲ್ಲ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರು. ಅವಾಗ ಅವರು ಆಯಿತು ಅಂದ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಈಗ ಕುಡಿಯೋದ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಮೊದಮದೇ ಯಾವಾಗಲೂ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಬೇಜಾರಾದ ಕುಡಿತಾರೆ, ಈಗ ಕುಡಿಯೋದ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ICPRD.
ಸ್ಟಾಪಿಂಗ್ ಡೌರಿ.
ನನ್ನ ತೊಂದರೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ವರದಕ್ಷಿಣೆ ಅಂತಹ ಒಂದು ಪಿಡುಗನ ನಮ್ಮ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಕಾಣ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೆ. ಸೊ ಈ ಥರ ತೊಂದರೆನ ನಮ್ಮ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಎಲ್ಲರ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಇರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದೇ ನನ್ನ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲೂ ಇತ್ತು. ನನ್ನ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿದ್ದಾಗ ಸೊ ನನ್ನ ಅಕ್ಕಳಾದ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಮದುವೆ ಆಗೋ ಸಂದರ್ಭ ಬಂದಿತ್ತು. ಆದರೆ ವರದಕ್ಷಿಣೆಯನ್ನು ಕೊಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಶಕ್ತಿ ಅಷ್ಟೊಂದು ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ಹೊಂದಿರಲಿಲ್ಲ. ಹೀಗಾಗಿ ನಾವು ICPRD ಬಳಿ ಹೋದಾಗ ICPRDಯಿಂದ ನಾವು ಸಲಹಾ ಸೂಚನೆಗಳನ್ನು ತಿಳ್ಕೊಂಡು ICPRDಯ ಸಲಹೆಯಿಂದ ನಾವು ಒಂದು ವರದಕ್ಷಿಣೆಯ ಅಂತಹ ಒಂದು ಪಿಡುಗನ್ನು ನಾವು ತಡೆಗಟ್ಟಲಾಯಿತು. ಸೊ ನಾವೀಗ ನನ್ನ ಅಕ್ಕನ ಮದುವೆ ಮಾಡಿದಾಗ ನನ್ನ ವರದಕ್ಷಿಣೆ ಅಂತೂ ಒಂದೂ ಕೊಡಲಿಲ್ಲ.
ಸ್ಟಾಪಿಂಗ್ ಫೀಮೇಲ್ ಫೀಟಿಸೈಡ್.
ಸ್ಟ್ರೀಟ್ ಥಿಯೇಟ್ರನ್ನ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ದೆ. ಆಗ ಒಂದು ಹುಡುಗ ಬಂದುಬಿಟ್ಟು ನಮ್ಮ ಭ್ರೂಣಾತೆ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಸ್ಟ್ರೀಟ್ ಥಿಯೇಟ್ರ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಇದು ನಮ್ಮೂರಲ್ಲೂ ನಡೆಯುತ್ತಿದೆ, ನಾನು ನೋಡಿದ್ದೀನಿ, ನಮ್ಮ ಇಲ್ಲೇ ತೋರಿಸ್ತೀನಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಕರ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹೋದ. ಆಮೇಲೆ ನಾವು ಓದು ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಅವು 4 ತಿಂಗಳು ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆಂಟ್ ಮಹಿಳೆ, ಆ ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆಂಟ್ಗೆ ಭ್ರೂಣ ಹತ್ಯೆ ಮಾಡಿಸೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಟ್ರೈ ಮಾಡ್ತಾಯಿದ್ರು. ನಾವು ಯೂತ್ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸು ಮತ್ತು ನಾವೆಲ್ಲ ಕೋಚ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಎಬ್ಬೆ ಮತ್ತು ಸೋಮೇಶ್ವರ ಪುರ ಯೂತ್ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಹೋಗಿ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಹೇಳ್ದು ಈ ರೀತಿ ಮಾಡೋದೆಲ್ಲ ತಪ್ಪು, ಹೆಣ್ಣು ಮಕ್ಕಳು ಭ್ರೂಣ ಹತ್ಯೆ ಮಾಡಬಾರ್ದು, ಆಮೇಲೆ ಕೊನೆಯದು ಒಂದಿನ ಪಾಂಡವರ ರಾಜ್ಯ ಆಗೋಯ್ತಿದೆ ನಮ್ಮ ದೇಶ, ಹೆಣ್ಮಕ್ಳು ಇಲ್ಲದಂಗೆ ಆಗೋಯ್ತಾರೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದಾಗ ಅವರು ಏಯ್ ಹೋಗಪ್ಪ ನಿಮ್ಗ್ಯಾಕೆ ಇವೆಲ್ಲ, ನಿಮ್ಗ್ಯಾಕೆ ಇವೆಲ್ಲ ಅನ್ನೋ ಉದ್ದೇಶದಿಂದ ನಮ್ಮನ್ನೇ ಬೈದು ಕಳಿಸ್ಬಿಟ್ರು. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ನಾವು ಬಿಡಲಿಲ್ಲ, ಇದೆಲ್ಲ ನಮಗೆ ಸೋಷಿಯಲ್ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್ಸನ್ನ ತಡಿಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಇವೆಲ್ಲ ಕಾಮನ್ ಆಗಿರ್ತದೆ. ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ನಾವೆಲ್ಲ ಹೋಗಿ ಗ್ರಾಮ ಪಂಚಾಯತಿ ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸು ಇವರನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ಮೀಟ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಮತ್ತು ಅವ್ರ ದೊಡ್ಡಪ್ಪ ಅನ್ನೋರು ಅವ್ರ ಕಂಟ್ರೋಲ್ ಇದ್ದಿದೆ, ಅವ್ರ ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ಓಲ್ ಕಂಟ್ರೋಲ್ ಇದ್ದಿದೆ ಅವ್ರ ದೊಡ್ಡಪ್ಪನ ಕೈಯಲ್ಲಿ. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಅವ್ರ ಕರ್ಕೊಬಂದು ಈ ರೀತಿ ಮಾಡಿಸೋದೆಲ್ಲ ತಪ್ಪು, ನೀವು ದೊಡ್ಡವರಾಗಿ ನೀವೇ ಈ ರೀತಿ ಮಾಡಿದ್ಮೇಲೆ ಇನ್ನು ಮಿಕ್ಕದವರೆಲ್ಲ ನಿಮ್ಮನ್ನೇ ನೋಡಿ ಕಲಿತಾರೆ ಅನ್ನೋ ಹೇಳಿದಾಗ ಅವರು ಹಂಗಾದ್ರೆ ನಂದು ತಪ್ಪಿದೆ, ನಾನು ಇನ್ಮೇಲಿಂದ ಮಾಡಲ್ಲ ಭ್ರೂಣ ಹತ್ಯೆನ ಅಂತ ನಾ ಹೇಳಿದಾಗ ನಮ್ಗೆಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ತುಂಬ ಖುಷಿ ಆಯಿತು. ಮತ್ತು ನಮ್ಮ ಯೂತ್ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಖುಷಿಯಾದರು. ಮತ್ತು ನಾವು ಈಗ ಹುಡುಗಿಯಾಗಿ 3 ತಿಂಗಳು ಮಗು ಇದೆ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ.
ಕ್ಲೋಸಿಂಗ್ ಲಿಕರ್ ಶಾಪ್ಸ್.
ಈ ಕಡೆ ಲಿಕ್ಕರ್ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್
ಆ ನಿಟ್ಟಿನಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಇವರಿಗೆ ಸಪೋರ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ. ಇವರು ಇದೇ ರೀತಿ ಮುಂದೆ ಕೂಡ ಇವರು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಹೋದ್ರೆ ಸಮಾಜಕ್ಕೆ ಮತ್ತು ನಮ್ಮದು ಒಂದು ಕಮ್ಯುನಿಟಿಗೆ ಒಳ್ಳೆಯದಾಗ್ತದೆ ಅಂತ.
ಇಫ್ ದಿ NGOs ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದಿ ಪೊಲೀಸ್ ಡಿಪಾರ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಕಮ್ ಟುಗೆದರ್ ಇನ್ ಸಚ್ ಇಶ್ಯೂಸ್, ಇಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿಕಮ್ ಅ ವೆರಿ ವರ್ತ್ ವೈಲ್ ವೆಂಚರ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ಲೆಸ್ ವರ್ಕ್ ವಿಚ್ ದಿ NGOs ಆರ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಡೂಯಿಂಗ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಡೂಯಿಂಗ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಲಾಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಕ್ರೈಮ್ಸ್ ವಿಲ್ ಕಮ್ ಡೌನ್.
ದ ಪ್ರಾಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಕ್ರಿಯೇಟೆಡ್ ಅ ಪವರ್ಫುಲ್ ಅಲಯನ್ಸ್ between young male advocates for gender equity and women microfinance groups at the local level. With this model, ICPRD has innovated a new product, gender-based violence linked to microfinance, a most effective connection leading to sustainable solutions for women's social and economic empowerment. Another highlight of the project has been that youth forums have succeeded in building alliances and establishing linkages with key stakeholders at the local level, women's self-help groups, village heads, panchayat members, teachers, Anganwadi workers. They are sensitizing schools and panchayats on the YFA-GBV approach. They have also interfaced with MPs effectively through fusion imagery. They are beginning to form girls' clubs. They are beginning to act as referrals on health issues of adolescent girls.
ಏನು ಗ್ರಾಮೀಣ ಪ್ರದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿ ನಡೀತಾ ಇತ್ತು ಏನು ಬಾಲ್ಯ ವಿವಾಹ ಇರ್ಬೋದು ಕುರಿತದ ಒಂದು ಚಟ ಇರ್ಬೋದು ಲಿಂಗ ಆಧಾರಿತ ಏನು ಮಹಿಳೆಗೆ ಹೆಣ್ಣು ಗಂಡು ಎಂಬ ಭಾವನೆ ಏನಿದೆ ಈ ಭಾವನೆಯನ್ನು ಹೋಗಲಾಡಿಸೋಕ್ಕೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಈ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆಯ ಜೊತೆಗೂಡಿ ಸಮನಾಗಿ ಒಟ್ಟಾಗಿ ನಾವು ಭಾಗವಹಿಸಿದ್ದೇವೆ
ತಕ್ರಿವನ್ ಬಹಳ ಸಾರೆ ಬಚ್ಚೆ ಹೇಗೆ ಮೋರ್ ದನ್ 50% ಸ್ಟೂಡೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಐ ಸಿ ಪಿ ಆರ್ ಡಿಗೆ ಮೆಂಬರ್ ಹೋ ಚುಕೆ ಔರ್ ಐ ಸಿ ಪಿ ಆರ್ ಡಿ ಸೆ ಹಮಾರೆ ಬಚ್ಚೋ ಕೋ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಬಿಹೇವಿಯರ್ ಮೇ ಚೇಂಜಸ್ ಬಹುತ ಆಯಾ ಜಾ ಬಹಳ ಸಾರೆ ಬಚ್ಚೆ ಸೆ ಲಡ್ಕಿಯೋ ಕೋ ಚೇಡನಾ ಗಲಾಟ ಕರ್ನಾ ಝಗಡಾ ಕರ್ನಾ ಯೇ ಸಬ್ ಕಾ ಲೇಕಿನ್ ಅಭಿ ಥೋಡಾ ಕಮ್ ಹೈ ಅಬ್ಸರ್ವ್ ಕರ್ತೀನಿ ಕ್ಲಾಸ್ ಮೇ ಔರ್ ಪಢಾಯಿ ಕೆ ತರಫ್ ಭಿ ಧ್ಯಾನ್ ದೇಂಗೆ
ಇದರಿಂದ ನಮಗೂ ಸಹ ಯೂಸ್ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತ ಅನಿಸ್ತು ಹುಡುಗರು ಮೀಟಿಂಗ್ ಮಾಡಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ನಾವು ಅಟೆಂಡ್ ಮಾಡಿದಾಗ ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾವು ಸಹ ಬೆಂಬಲವಾಗಿ ನಿಂತ್ಕೊಂಡ್ರೆ ಇನ್ನೂ ಈ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆ ಮುಂದುವರಿತಾ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ ನನ್ನ ಉದ್ದೇಶ ಆಯಿತು ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾವೇ ಹೇಳಿ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ನಾವು ಸೇರ್ಕೋತೀವಿ ನಿಮ್ಗೇನು ಸಪೋರ್ಟ್ ಬೇಕಾದ್ರೂ ನಾವು ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದಾಗ ಅವರು ಸಹ ಒಪ್ಕೊಂಡು ಇದನ್ನ ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಸೇರಿಸಿದ್ರು
ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಶಿವರಾಜ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಚನ್ನಪತ್ನ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಬಿನ್ ವಿತ್ ದ ಪ್ರಾಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಸಿನ್ಸ್ 2006 ಹಿ ಇಸ್ 18 ಇಯರ್ಸ್ ಓಲ್ಡ್ and is doing his diploma in engineering. He comes from a poor socio-economic background. Identifying his potential, his interest and skills, he was appointed part-time staff with the project at the regional office in Bangalore. He has become an important pivot of the project, even conducting training on gender issues with YFA GBVs and translating and interpreting from the local language Kannada to English when required. He has emerged as a leader at the local level, lending sustainability to the project.
This project is on the verge of a breakthrough in the history of women's empowerment. Many who have tirelessly worked to mainstream gender issues will be heartened to note the new role of young men as allies in fighting the many manifestations of gender-based violence at the grassroots, not the theoretical level anymore. May I now invite young and old men as re-socialized citizens to walk with us, to work with us towards our common vision of a gender equitable world.
This is one example of an effort at the community level that is engaging particularly young men. And to meet these young men is an experience in and of itself of empowerment because they feel their lives have changed. They're not only helping to protect the women and girls in their villages, but they have liberated themselves in many ways and know what an extraordinary difference they're making. So let me now ask Nisha Biswal from USAID to talk about a range of programs that USAID is engaged in and supporting, how we take programs like this and others to scale that we know are effective, and just generally what some of the best practices are.
Great. Thank you very much, Milan, and thank you for inviting me to participate in this very important event and to be part of the 16 Days of Activism. I want to start off by just asking a question of our audience. How many of you personally know of someone who has experienced gender-based violence? Wow. That is a pretty telling statistic right there. For me, this is also not an abstract topic. I became aware of this issue very deeply in a personal way at a young age when I learned of a very close friend who had been beaten by her husband and mother-in-law in India. And as a teenager learning of this, I felt very powerless to help. And I felt very frustrated that there were so few options available to this young girl in India. And so, you know, it has been an issue that has stayed with me throughout my career. As a development professional, I have had an opportunity to meet with women in a variety of settings. Women in Eastern Congo, where I went to a village. It was kind of a pioneering effort, actually. It was a small village that had been set up solely for women who had been survivors of really atrocious violence. And I had the ability to meet with these women in a closed environment to talk about their experience. And it wasn't the atrocities that I took away, because they were horrific. And we all have heard about some of the horrific violence that has occurred in Congo. What I took away from that experience was the spirit and the resilience of the women, the survivor instinct of these women who, having suffered what they had, were determined to carve out a life for themselves and their children. And really, in the women that I have met with around the world, that has been the key takeaway, is not that feeling of powerlessness, but actually the survivor instinct, the instinct of power, of taking back that power that I have seen in so many women around the world. And it's really what motivates our work. It's really what gives us that opening and that opportunity, is that we have partners on the ground who are willing to do the most courageous things themselves, take the biggest risks themselves. And so here we have an opportunity to try to empower and facilitate that work and carry it forward. And so if I can talk just a little bit about what USAID tries to focus on, I'm really interested in getting to the dialogue portion and to have that back and forth conversation. But, you know, USAID really does look at this from a very multifaceted approach, that to address gender-based violence is, one, important because it touches upon every aspect of the work that AID does in a country. And it is fundamental to the success and the development of these countries, because women make up 50% of the workforce. And so if you are not empowering these women to thrive and to succeed, you're really missing the opportunity to grow. USAID has worked in kind of the totality of the GBV area in trying to reduce domestic violence, intimate partner violence, rape, sexual abuse, working with men and women at risk with HIV, in trafficking, in FMG, in child marriage, and other harmful traditional practices. And it is a generational issue and not something that we can affect in a day or a year. But it requires a commitment every day, every year, to be able to affect that generational change. We have spent about $160 million since 2001 in 70 countries focusing on anti-trafficking activities. And we are currently working in about 40 countries around the world on prevention, protection, intervention, and enforcement issues. More broadly, AID is seeking to address the root causes of violence by improving prevention and protection services, working with law enforcement agencies, with polices and judiciaries, responding to the legal, psychosocial, health, education, and economic needs of those affected by gender-based violence, and to support legislation and its enforcement, as the ambassador pointed out rightly, because in a lot of countries you have some very good laws on the books that are not enforced. And while our work supports at-risk populations of survivors and survivors of violence, we recognize that you can't focus just on the women. You have to focus on the surrounding community, the men and the boys, that the behavioral change comes when you have a community-based approach. And so USAID is increasingly looking at more holistic programs that address not only the needs of the women, but also how to make that attitudinal behavioral change in the surrounding community. And we saw the excellent work that Nandini is doing in India in that video. I had the privilege of meeting some of those boys when I was there recently, and I'm very happy that USAID has been able to support that work. Let me just talk briefly about some of the principles around the work that USAID does. First and foremost, respect the safety, the rights, and the confidentiality of the survivors of GBV. Support multi-sectoral approaches, not just to address not just the symptoms, but also the root causes. Include a development and human rights perspective into our programming so that we frame gender-based violence not only as a development problem, but also as a violation of human rights for the communities and societies to be held accountable to those rights. To encourage partnerships with a range of stakeholders, academic and research institutions, organizations, advocacy groups, NGOs, faith-based organizations, private sectors, and then obviously host country governments and partners, local governments as well. Ensure monitoring and evaluation as an essential component of gender-based violence programs. And we have supported initiatives such as the development of a global compendium of monitoring and evaluation indicators on violence against women and girls, which would use quantitative methods to measure multiple aspects of program performance and achievement across all these sectors. And then finally, as I was mentioning, working with men and boys in with communities at large so that we can change behaviors and attitudes over the long term. Just a couple of examples of where we're working and the programs that we're doing. We talked a little bit about the wonderful program that we have in India. In Yemen, USAID has been working with has been working with mobile clinics and community members on child marriage to try to. Let me see. Okay. Sorry, I'm focusing on Asia, and so the Yemen program is a little new to me, so let me just read my notes a little bit carefully here. As a result of community mobilization efforts, including school and community-based awareness sessions and mobile clinics, community members pledged to ban child marriage and set marriage dowry for 400,000 Yemeni rials in order to deter the traditional practice of trade marriage. So the baseline and community survey demonstrates that in Yemen, in girls age 10 to 17, that this program has contributed to a shifting of the marriage age from 14 to 17. This project was instrumental in averting 53 girl child and 26 boy child marriages in the villages that it was working in. And so now USAID is replicating this program in additional districts to try to scale this up more nationally. In Ethiopia, where nearly half of all girls are married by the age of 18, USAID has been partnering with girls' advisory committees in more than 3,700 public schools to prevent child marriage and to encourage unmarried and married girls to attend and complete school. These programs are empowering girls and women to train and support law enforcement officials and community and religious leaders. Through these programs, we believe some 1,800 early marriages have been deferred or canceled. So that's just a smattering of some of the programs that we have. Obviously, a lot remains to be done. We have many, many challenges ahead of us. And so, you know, this is an area that we will continue to try to integrate gender-based violence policies into all the work that we do. And I look forward to continuing that conversation in a few minutes. Thank you.
Thank you, Nisha, so much, and to everybody at USAID for its commitment and the work that is done to support these efforts. Now we have with us Anthony Porter, who is the co-founder of A Call to Men, to talk to us about the ways in which his organization is engaging boys and men in a civil society movement to end violence against women and girls.
Thank you. Thank you, Ambassador, panelists, all you folks out there. I'm with the Call to Men. We're a national organization here in the United States, made up of men and women, as the ambassador stated. And our work is around domestic and sexual violence prevention, ending violence against women, ending men's violence against women. We come at this work from a perspective that men's violence against women is rooted in a patriarchy. So what that says to us, as you've heard from the other members of the panels, is not just about the bad guys. It's, for us, it's really about the collective socialization of men, that all men have a part in this here. While most men don't hit, don't abuse, we're all part of this collective socialization. We call it the foundation of manhood. And within that foundation, we collectively as men have been taught to have less value in women, to view women as objects, particularly sexual objects, and to view women as the property of men. This is the collective socialization of men. This is all men. I may believe a little bit of this, and you may believe a little bit of that, but what's also equally as important is that we all, as men, collectively understand the thinking of men in general. We haven't done a lot of international work. Recently, we've been working throughout Africa, and in speaking with men from various countries here in the States, we find this across all cultural bounds, that all men have a hand in this. So we believe that we believe that if women can end men's violence against women, it'd be over. It would have ended. That men have to be part of this solution. We got to get real clear on this is not a woman's issue. This room here represents many rooms that we find ourselves in where 90% of the folks in the room are women and 10% of the folks in the room are men. That continues to support the ideology that this is a woman's issue. We have to get real clear this is a human rights issue and that we all have a hand in this. So this collective socialization of men, let me back up a second and say, you know, for many years now, in this country and abroad as well, we've been learning and getting more effective and efficient at reacting to the violence. So we have a lot of energy and resources in victim services, a lot of energy and resources in holding men accountable. But what we've also learned over the years is that in of itself, the violence is not declining. And in some communities, is increasing, it's rising. So we need to continue to have great victim services. We need to continue to hold men accountable. But we really, the goal is to end the violence. In order to end the violence, we have to move toward prevention. And I'm really honored to be here and to be in your presence with this great group of panelists speaking about this very issue. To prevent the violence, men have to become part of the solution. Good men, well-meaning men, righteous men, like the men in this room. The majority of men in our country and abroad don't perpetrate violence against women, but we stand by as it happens. That we have to begin to really take a good hard look at we as men collectively, where are we at? Are we part of the problem or are we part of the solution? And so these are the efforts of our work in prevention is challenging men to really to stand up, to speak out. As you've heard, as you've seen, finding our voice, finding our place in this work, that prevention efforts require men to be at the table. So our work with men and boys, we find ourselves on college campuses. We work a lot with sports. We enjoy working with men who have influence over other men. They can really expedite these efforts. So we spend a lot of time in youth sports. We spend a lot of time working with coaches. We work with pro sports here in the country as well, churches, military, law enforcement, places you will find us on a regular basis. We've been putting a lot of energy, and I appreciate so much what we experience here. We put a lot of energy here in the United States in working abroad, known as NGOs, here in our country, CBOs, community-based organizations. Now, we put a lot of focus on urban areas, but that's not to say that the problem exists only in urban areas. And we need to be real clear about that. But we put a lot of energy working in places where historically a lot of energy has not been placed. So you'll find us in inner cities working with men and boys. We've also broadened our scope to not just talk about domestic and sexual violence prevention, but to talk about just simply from a standpoint of what we call concepts of healthy manhood. Because concepts of healthy manhood is domestic and sexual violence prevention. Just teaching men what it really means to be a man, redefining how we have collectively learned to define manhood, redefining that to teach men what it really means to be a good man. And in many of these organizations, there's a captive audience of boys and girls there all day. We need to really infiltrate, maybe I shouldn't say it that way, but really get in there and really help to restructure some of what's being taught in educating men and boys as to what it means to be a man. So that's really the foundation of our work. One of the ways that we're successful in engaging men, because you can have a man identifying his wife as property, and then you ask him what's the world he wants to see for his daughter, and it's a completely different world. All right, he wants to see men respectful. He wants to see men very appropriate. So we spend a lot of time engaging men around questions around the world they want to see for their daughters. How do you want to see men acting and behaving? You know, what's the world you want to see for your granddaughter? It's not difficult to engage men. And I think highly enough, well enough, I love men, you know, to think highly enough that we can be part of this process. But we do have to be engaged. So thank you very much, and I look forward to the Q&A as well, and appreciate so much this opportunity to be with you.
Thank you so much. And our last panelist before we open it up to all of you is Carol Kurtzig, who is the president of the Avon Foundation. And Carol is representative of the multi-stakeholder way in which we have to go about addressing this issue, because there is a clear role for the business community. In the United States, those of us who've been active on this issue here know that the business community played a significant role in the passage of the Violence Against Women Act and has been engaged in a lot of workplace awareness programs, support of shelters, and so on. So, Carol?
Thank you, Milan. I'm very proud to be here today to talk about Avon's commitment to ending violence against women, really representing the corporate sector and encouraging others in our sector to take a strong stand on this issue, because it's something that affects our customers, it affects our employees, and most importantly, it's the right thing to do as committed corporate citizens. And I have to say, from Avon's perspective, before we got involved in this cause in 2004, we surveyed our customers, our representatives globally, our employees, and we found out in country after country around the world that this was an issue of greatest importance to women everywhere, top two issues in every country. At Avon, our corporate mission is really to improve women's lives globally, and our commitment to empowering women is really embedded in our corporate DNA. The company was founded in 1886 on the revolutionary concept that women could earn money and have their own entrepreneurial businesses outside the home. And that was at a time when women had virtually no role outside the home and were still 34 years away from gaining the right to vote in the United States. So today, on the eve of our 125th anniversary, we have nearly 7 million Avon representatives around the world. Almost 95% of them are women, and we advance them credit for their orders, making Avon the largest engine of economic opportunity for women globally. Collectively, Avon representatives earn more than $4.5 billion selling Avon in their own businesses around the world. Avon's global workforce is also one of the most diverse among this country's largest companies. Over 60% of our employees are women, as are almost half of our top managers and our board members. And Andrea Jung,
our first female CEO, has more than doubled the company's size to over $10 billion in her 11 years as CEO, which is the longest tenure of any woman CEO on the Fortune 500, and I should also point out, compares with the average tenure for male CEOs on that list of 3.5 years. But beyond giving women the tools to earn money, Avon Global Philanthropy has donated more than $800 million for causes that matter most to women, making us the world's largest corporate-affiliated philanthropies focused solely on issues related to women. We're proud to be the top corporate supporter of the breast cancer cause globally and a leader in violence to end women. In 2004, we launched our Speak Out Against Domestic Violence program because it was really unacceptable to us that one in three women around the world would be victims of abuse or violence in her lifetime. In the U.S. alone, domestic violence is a leading cause of homelessness for women and children, and more than half of domestic violence victims report losing their jobs as a result of abuse. To help change those statistics, Avon Global Philanthropy has already donated more than $30 million for education, direct services, and prevention programs aimed at reducing domestic and gender violence. But we do more than donate money. We also raise awareness by engaging our global network of Avon representatives to distribute educational information as well as to direct victims to services and local programs. We also sell millions of affordable women's empowerment products, like the ring I'm wearing, featuring the infinity symbol to represent the unlimited possibilities for women when they are not subject to violence. Net proceeds from these empowerment products help us fund this important work, and since Avon began one of the very first corporate cause marketing programs in 1992, fundraising products like these have raised more than $300 million around the world for women's causes. We're especially proud of the public-private partnerships we've developed to maximize Avon's own unique assets and to expand our reach, first throughout the United States and now around the world. In the United States, we've funded a broad range of partnership programs with a particular emphasis on those that help children living in homes where there's violence in order to break the cycle of domestic violence for the future. We've also prioritized programs aimed at girls from 18 to 24, since those are most likely to be victims of abuse and violent relationships. And we've just recently launched programs to create economic self-sufficiency that will allow women to leave abusive and violent relationships successfully. In 2007, we began our global expansion of this program with fundraising and grant-making programs now operating in over 50 Avon markets around the world. And beyond these country-very specific programs, on a global scale, we've partnered with UNIFEM by donating more than $1.25 million to the UN Trust Fund to end violence against women. And we've also created the Avon Global Center for Women and Justice at Cornell University Law School to accelerate the passage and, more importantly, even the implementation of laws that treat violence against women as human rights issues. This year, in honor of International Women's Day in March, we partnered with the State Department and Vital Voices to launch our global partnership to end violence against women. We convened cross-sector delegations from 15 countries in Washington for a three-day summit to help them work on development of strategies that would remove barriers to ending domestic violence, sexual violence, and trafficking in their countries. And since March, all 15 country delegations have been working very hard to advance those strategies. Their ambitious plans are very far-ranging, and they include things like premiering the powerful Play 7, which demonstrates women's triumph over violence through true stories. Well-known actresses have performed these roles in India and for the first time ever in Spanish in Argentina just 2 weeks ago. Our delegations in those countries are using the play as an advocacy and public awareness tool to engage new communities in the discussion of ways to end violence. Our delegations are leading efforts to build new family justice centers in Mexico to offer much-needed services for victims of violence and their children, and they're developing shelters for victims of trafficking and sexual violence in Turkey and South Africa. They're launching new awareness campaigns in India, in the media, such as Making the Invisible Visible in Mexico, which features a media tour to discuss the issues with leading editors and journalists. In Russia, our delegation is working to pass a new law specific to domestic violence, and in Mexico, they're working to pass a law to protect victims of violence with a new uniform protective order, because the laws vary so much there from state to state. Our delegations in the Czech Republic are supporting new research on the economic effects of domestic violence to persuade more businesses to get involved. And many of our delegations are prioritizing the engagement and recruitment of men and boys to speak out to accelerate change by creating new behavior expectations, such as Argentina's one-man campaign and Brazil's online engagement strategy. We took another proud step earlier this year to support those in the front lines of the work to address this pandemic with the Avon Foundation's $500,000 grant to the Secretary's Fund for Global Women's Leadership here at the State Department. And I am honored to be here today for the presentation of those Avon Awards for the elimination of gender-based violence. Ambassador Vivere will announce the grant recipient shortly, and I know that you, like we, will be inspired when you hear about the crucial, groundbreaking work of these outstanding organizations doing amazing things all around the world. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Carol. She mentioned the awards that were submitted to us with proposals through our embassies from NGOs on the ground. They are focused on helping support frontline, very innovative efforts to attack this challenge that we all confront. And I'm not going to be able, because of time, to list all of the recipients, but they will be notified and we will put out a release on this. But there have been recipients this time around in this tranche of grants that came in, proposals that came in through our embassies, and which a panel of experts in this area reviewed and made their decisions on. There were many, many submissions because the need is great. But the countries where the NGOs will be receiving Avon grants are from Egypt, Turkey, Mexico, Argentina, Jamaica, Liberia, Cambodia, and India. And I am happy to say that one of the grants will be going to ICPRD, which is with us here today. So now we turn to all of you. If you could just please tell us your name and where you're from and to whom you want to submit your question, or if you want to make a comment or describe an effort in which you are engaged. And I will try with these bright lights to see the hands that are going up. First one here, and then next to her, and then down there. Please, Manas. Is there, I guess you have to use the mic. That's fine. Just hit the button at the bottom. It says MIC.
Yes. I want to thank you, Milan, for, as always, bringing such a stellar group of people and to bring focus on women's issues and on violence, mainstreaming, actually, this idea into the State Department as well as across the embassies. But can you hear me? Oh, yes. I'm Manaz Afghami. I'm president of Women's Learning Partnership. We work in partnership with 20 countries, mostly in the MENA region, but in other parts of the globe as well. I saw that throughout these brilliant presentations, including your own, there was a very solid and important emphasis on patriarchy as the root cause. I have both a comment and a question to anyone of the panel who wants to address it. The comment is that in our work, which has to do with empowerment of women and leadership training, we've come to the conclusion that at the base of many of the evils that we're facing in the world is the idea of the type of leadership that is being exercised, not necessarily limited to the 50% which we all wish to have of women in decision-making positions, that the type of leadership that we are all teaching and learning and exercising has to do with authoritarian, top-down, hegemonic, competition-based, aggressive, win-lose kind of leadership. And this is something that we have to have in mind if we're going to be changing not only the issue of violence against women, which is at the root of a lot of the problems, but also the way people interact with each other in decision making in many different areas. And the that type of leadership has to do with addressing the issue of patriarchy, the role of men, masculinities, culture change, and changing social attitudes. And I was asking if in the programs that are being used and in the programs that are being developed, that type of leadership change, the interaction between people that involves respect, togetherness, win-win situations, is being addressed in as a foundation for changing the issue of violence all the way in a holistic way from the domestic violence all the way to conflict, issues of war, issues of aggression, and so forth, which they are all interrelated. So I appreciate any kind of reaction that you might have. Thank you.
Who would like to? Nandini?
I just take half a minute to tell you a bit about because I think what you're really talking about is sort of an inclusive, leadership rather than a hierarchical one. Now, one of the things that is fundamental to why we do what we do in this project is that we want to make these changes at the familial level. And when we started, bringing in these young men, we were looking at a paradigm shift of the power equation within the family. I mean, this was one of the objectives, but we didn't know we'd be able to do it. So at this point, just a small illustration, when there is a wife beating incident in the family, and the man of the house, the head of the household, quote unquote, tries to beat the woman, most of our fusion imagery shows the young men and the young girl coming together with the woman. And there, fundamentally, because I think we talk such very, very big macro issues, and that's fine. But when a project can address a shift in the power equation, which makes inclusive the girl child, the male child, the mother, and the father, that he decides one or two incidents of that, and therefore the power equations have changed there, that they are not going to allow him to do that sort of. So I'm just giving you a small illustration that this is absolutely in our mind, that we are addressing these things.
Okay. My name is Liza Gross, and I am the Executive Director of the International Women's Media Foundation. I apologize to Ambassador Brevier because she's heard me ask this question before. My question is directed to Ms. Kurtzig, Dr. Azar, and Mr. Porter. First, Ms. Kurtzig, you mentioned some initiative in Mexico whereby you are getting journalists and traditional media involved in better understanding these issues. I would ask for some more details about that. And to the two of you, are you engaging traditional media or involving yourselves with traditional media in any way to help traditional media better understand and report and cover the issues of violence against women, or the initiatives to end violence against women? Thank you.
The program in Mexico is being launched by our Mexican delegation as part of the Global Partnership Program. So there are six or seven, actually, organizations, both our Avon country market there and their PR people are working on this very hard with NGOs and government officials. And I think that they have done a great job of PR around our breast cancer cause in Mexico, and they're sort of applying some of the same standards to reach out and really educate and inform, because they know that one of the most important objectives is really to change public awareness and public understanding of the issue. And that's why we originally adopted the terminology speak out against domestic violence when we launched our program in this country, because it's a very big challenge to change behavior. But to get more people talking about the issue is what I think is the first step that's required. And so they're doing a multi-city media tour in Mexico and meeting with different you know, journalists in every location, and I can get you more specific information if you're interested in that country.
We do a street theater workshop, a national street theater workshop every year, where we bring in members of parliament and the media together. So this is in the rural areas. It's in the villages, not urban. So we've had a great experience with the media, because the national media also is very has been very supportive. The Hindu, particularly, in India, has been very supportive of our work, both in Karnataka and not only talking about cases, but solutions. For example, when we had this experience of you know, alcohol brewing, and there was near violence between our groups and theirs, the Hindu was one of the first groups that we called from New Delhi, and they took the issue up. So we've had, and because street theater also involves a lot of, that's media and communication too. So we have the local media, really local traditional media, not the highbrow urban and big city media, but we are very, very engaged with them because we think they are civil society. They're part of us. So there's a rape case, it's in the news. And if we have a solution, we tell them. So we're all engaged and networked together, if that answers something.
And yes, we've been involved a great deal with local and national media. Almost every city where we've gone to present, local media is always there. We take that opportunity. We speak with them prior to attending the event to help engage folks who attend. They're at the events where we have an opportunity to share with them to reach a larger audience, you know, of our goals of the event, the purpose and reason we're there. So we speak with them a lot, particularly in the cities we attend. We helped, we were the visionaries behind a book that we collaborated with the National Football League called Dedicated to Daughters. The whole concept of, it's a coffee table book with about 70 players in the book, really speaking, you know, pictures of them and their daughters and speaking about why ending violence against women is important to them, pretty much using the idea of through the eyes of your daughters. We got a great deal of media attention. There was book signings all over the country with various players. We helped promote a couple of hip-hop artists who, you know, who took our language, our message, and put it to music, and then help them to find audiences around the country. So it's definitely a tool we have to use. And in this day and age, Facebook, Twitter, and everything else, things that we stayed away from, we have to really get involved in.
Hi, thank you for sharing your unique perspectives today on this important subject. I'm Elizabeth Ross, and I'm with Relief International. I oversee humanitarian relief and development projects in Central Asia and Africa. My question, we're one of many international NGOs that's been working on gender-based violence through many different sectors, through health, nutrition, livelihoods, education, and we're just, of course, one of many. My question to you all, perhaps particularly Dr. Azad and Mr. Porter, who mentioned working with local NGOs and community-based groups, is how might you see the international NGO community working better on the engagement of men and boys in the programming we're doing together or in our approaches? We make quite a big commitment to what I think the USAID representative talked about, you know, that we must include men and boys in our programming as part of the solution. But I think it's not coming through as well as we intended to. And so since the international NGO community in contexts such as Haiti or Pakistan are really side-by-side partners with civil society, with small groups and large groups who are community-based organizations that are living and breathing this every day. Is there anything we could be doing more of, better? What are we doing terribly in bringing men and boys more front and center into the solution? It's a big question, but I thought maybe some methodology might come from any of the panel today. Thank you very much.
I have to relate a personal experience to Ambassador Babir. I think she was the one first person who looked at this whole perception in India, for example. We've been doing this work in the last 4 years. But she had one look at it, and then, you know, being at the level that she is, she could see that this is very important, that we have to make those macro changes. And that's what we said, that you need a perception, you need a mentor. You need a mentor for these whole issues. Because you see this, for 4 years we've been struggling, but it took her one look to go and talk to the US Congress about it. And then after that, there was a lot of publicity for us, and then we're going, the whole concept has become very, very vital. So first thing, I think you need mentors. Number two, because you need people to talk about it to the people who matter at the places that matter to say that this is a paradigm change. Number two is that I think a lot of the money that's going on is going on into very useful and relevant strategies for empowering women and women's rights. But I think we're stagnating there. And if we have to look at, say, 20 years hence or 40 years hence, you have to bring in the schools. Somebody was talking about sports clubs. You see, the young men don't like to do the things that traditionally girls did in traditional societies. So we had to go to cricket matches. We had to go, you know, to other sports events. We had to go to, you know, football matches, volleyball matches. These are the sort of things that they like. So, you know, you need to look at, think out of the box. Don't think of, you know, giving them didactic, but very boring lectures, training. No, make it creative. Street theater, their energy is channelized. They have a status there. They can go to the local government official. So give them status. Teach them a new way. Go their way. And that's very crucial with youth. And that, I think, is what international NGOs need to start. Start thinking out of the box. And don't think about, as one of the girls' clubs, we suddenly have a spawning of girls' clubs. So the girls' club said, why are you getting those guys to do our work? You know, I mean, violence against women is our work. Why are you getting? So the whole, they said, we could do this easier. Why are you doing it through these boys? And then we told them that it is very important that we need to engage new actors because to have a high impact strategy. So these are the sort of new things that you need to look at, not only place all your strategies into one basket. It's as simple as that.
If I may just add here, you know, something like what UNICEF or some of these other organizations have done, and that is to fund campaigns, let's say for polio eradication or campaigns for eradication of other diseases, where they have got local, you know, people who are heroes in the public imagination to actually come as sponsors in advertising campaigns for those. So, I mean, you were talking of Pakistan, I would say cricketers, film stars, sportsmen, these would be, you know, ideal spokesmen or even spokeswomen for these causes, which would give it much wider acceptability. I think that's something which could be tried. It hasn't been tried on this side. It's been tried for disease eradication programs. But I think to try it also for some programs like this would have an impact relevant to that society. So you have to find in each society a person or personalities which could have resonance in that society.
Anthony and Alicia. I don't want to be redundant, so I just a couple of things that I agree with everything that was said, and just a couple extra things I can add to that is one of the things that the work has also been politicized, and we have to really be careful about that. Also, you know, the thing that can be troubling and we have to watch out for is when we talk about resources, and that's the politicized part of the work, resources are scarce. We don't want to take resources from victim services that are needed there to do prevention work. But at the same time, prevention work, in some respect, long-term, can be viewed as victim services. It lessens the needs. But there's the challenge there for us to understand that and how to work together and not to compete. So that's something that's very, very important, is not competing. It's very important that when men come to do this work that they understand that they come to join in, that they come on, you know, that we, I know that when I get here to do this work, I'm here on the backs of women. And I need to understand what that means. So we need to engage men, get involved, but they really need to have a deeper understanding. Women have been doing this for a long time by themselves, so it's rightful that they're kind of guarded, cautious, suspicious of when we show up. And historically, history has dictated that when we do show up, we act out. So, you know, there's reason for that discomfort and being guarded when we show up. And what men usually take that, and then they just run and say, see, they don't want us here anyway. So they'll just take that as a reason to run. So I think we just have to be conscious of a lot of these dynamics. And one thing I'll just say that was somewhat said is that we have to do things differently, because men historically have been, when we're in this room where we're afraid, because that means I'm in here, that means they must think I hit. I'm here, they must think that I assault. So when we bring men to the table, so much of it has really been around accountability, that we have to really kind of reframe this as to why men are here. Because we get afraid to be here, we're scared to be here, and because being here means we're part of the problem in a way that we don't want to be defined. So how do we redefine that as well?
I just want to add very briefly that I think the more fundamental challenge for both the donor community and for the implementers is how to really approach these issues from a holistic, integrated way. We are also used to devising and designing our programs to meet very specific needs, and yet this is an issue that needs to be gotten to in perhaps a more roundabout way that you can do with holistic programs. One of the comments that Tony made in his presentation about going to the men and boys where they are on the issues that they care about, so that you're not always engaging them on this space, but you're engaging them on other programs that you're doing to work with those communities and building this into that. And so I think it's kind of thinking outside the box, thinking creatively, thinking more holistically. It's a challenge for the implementers, and it's a challenge for donors to be able to fund and allow programs and value programs that do that. So I think that that's something that we all have to work through together. And we have a lot of reporting requirements that we impose on ourselves, that Congress imposes on us, that try to quantify everything in narrow categories. And those narrow categories don't always allow themselves to these more integrated approaches, which are going to get you the better impact over the long term. And so I think that that's something we can work together as we move forward.
Unfortunately, we only have time for one more. So the gentleman, yes.
Thank you very much, and thank you for having this seminar organized. Thank you to Ambassador Verbier. I come from Embassy of Finland. My name is Marko Kauppinen. I come from a country where we have a president. She's a woman, obviously, we have also Prime Minister as a woman. My president has always said, as it comes to these difficulties or violence and against women and so forth, how we could get out of it is education, education, education. In my country, we have free education from the first grade to the university. There, the boys and girls, when men and women go together, they learn and they grow up to equality, egalité. And this is kind of a natural way to sort of learn to treat each other in equal way. Of course, it's easy to say we are only 5 million, anyway, good example. And this is something we are bringing also to developing countries where we are very actively promoting education. Especially to girls, but also boys, which are also very important players in this thing. This is the holistic way, as you mentioned there. So once again, free education is one key into solution, as part of the solution when we talk about diminishing violation against women. Thank you.
Thank you. And you remind me of a victim of terrible abuse. Several years ago, Mukhtar Amai went to use a small settlement that she got in the legal adjudication of her situation. She invested in a school for girls and a school for boys in her village. And when asked why she used that small settlement in this way, she said, "Nothing will ever change in my village until education comes here." And she enrolled herself because she herself was illiterate in the school for girls. So thank you for that final comment. Thank you all for joining us. First of all, our panel, Anthony and Nandini and Nisha and Carol and Ambassador Mira. And all of you for coming, all of you who have been listening and will have your own conversations in our embassies around the world, and those of you who will watch on delayed broadcast. This annual observance to combat violence against women and girls, these 16 days, offer us all an opportunity to renew our commitment to dealing with this terrible problem. Yes, because it does significantly affect women and girls, but also because it affects all of us, men and boys. It robs our world of the potential that could be unleashed to the benefit of all of us. It makes us all less of the human beings we should and can be. So we thank you all for the work you do. We hope you will continue it in the months and years to come. It is a long process, but one in hope. We hope with innovative ideas, the kinds of work that was described here today, taken to scale, and so many other wonderful examples that exist around the world will enable us all to do a much better job. I also want to thank the staff of the Office of Global Women's Issues here at State and everyone who has worked with us to make this possible. And we continue to work with all of you in the days ahead to confront violence against women and girls and to put an end to it in the hopefully near term. Thank you all very much.